football. Manchester United, Liverpool at 1, Sky Sports HD 1. Chelsea, Blackpool at 3:30, also Sky Sports HD 1. And Kilmarnock, Celtic at 12:30, Sky Sports HD 4.
You're watching Sky Sports.
Round 16 of this season's IndyCar Series comes from the unique twin ring oval circuit in Motegi, Japan. Coming up, highlights of the penultimate IndyCar race of the year. Hello and welcome to highlights of the only IndyCar race to be held outside of the Americas. And for three Japanese drivers, Hideki Muto, Takuma Sato and Roger Yazukawa, it promises to be a very special day. I'm joined in the studio by our regular expert Johnny Molum, and it's a pleasure to welcome Indy Lights driver Pippa Mann, who won at Kentucky 2 weeks ago. Congratulations, fantastic race.
Thank you, and it's great to be here.
You did very well to keep out of all the action that was going on, though, at that particular Indy Lights race. I mean, it was mayhem to start with.
Yeah, there was a bit of mayhem for the first few laps, but my goal was to try and run away and hide, and thankfully I managed to get away with that, and I was able to run away and hide, so...
Well, you did. This is what you missed, of course. You'll be quite pleased to have not got involved in something like this. It's all too common in oval racing, but one thing's certain... Pippa, when you finally got going proper, lap one right the way through to lap 67 and the checkered flag, you made it look easy.
Well, it's never that easy, but it was nice to be able to make it look easy, I guess, for everybody else. My team just did such a great job, and it was really amazing to actually get to win the race for them. We came so close the previous weekend, and to win it the next weekend was really great.
Brilliant. I do like it when we get a British winner. Now then, didn't get that in the IndyCars, of course, although Dan's been going good just lately. Elio Castroneves in Kentucky, Johnny, looked very good.
Yes, and I mean, this is obviously something, it's got his sort of, there's an outside chance still, obviously, for him, and he just wants to finish the year strongly. Wasn't very good at the beginning of the year, had a few issues, had that big overtaking, did he block, did he not block, so I suspect that that would have been a sweet victory for him.
Going to be very handy as the season moves into the last two races to have someone that's going this quick in the Penske team. Maybe a bit of backup for Will Power coming his way there, Pippa.
Yeah, Will's been learning the ovals and getting better and better and better at them this year. Excuse me. But it's something that's been really new to him, so he didn't do this much before. Excuse me, I've got a frog in my throat now.
I have that effect on people, you know.
Yeah, you wish.
Will's been learning the ovals and getting better and better and better at them, but he's going up for the championship now. It's coming down to the wire on the ovals. Dario's got so much experience, and it'll be really great for him to have such a quick teammate who he can get data from, learn from, maybe even get some extra car direction set up from. And even if it's just someone else to take maximum points away from Dario, it all helps the cause.
Power's got Castroneves and Briscoe to help him, but of course Scott Dixon, who goes quick round this place, Johnny, is there to help Dario, presumably.
Yeah, I mean, he was obviously a little bit disappointed in qualifying, Scott, but I have to say my money's on Dario, even though he's got a big points deficit, because for the simple reason that I think that Will Power is a little bit obviously he's a real novice in this, and he's going to be a little bit nervous, and he certainly showed a little bit of nerves towards the end of the season, whereas Dario, I think, has got, he knows exactly what he has to do, and he's got no pressure because he's coming from behind.
Ganassi teammate Scott Dixon won this race last year from the pole position. The perfect set, almost, you've got to say, in the Indy Japan 300 last year. Kiwi looking very cool indeed. Well, it's a crucial race of the year as Dario Franchitti closes the gap on Willpower. It's down to 17 points, but with 50 points available for a win, plus a point for pole position and two for the most laps led, this is going down to the wire. Power has 5 wins this year, all on street tracks. Dario, 3 wins, all on ovals. Scott Dixon still has a mathematical chance. Elio Castroneves does too. Briscoe would love to add to his 1 win of the year. Ryan Hunter-Reay and Tony Kanaan are also one-time winners this year. Marco Andretti heads a brace of Brits. Dan Weldon is on a roll. He and Justin Wilson could both do with ending the year on a high. Like Dan Weldon, this is the scene of Danica Patrick's first win, and she needs a result to revive her 2010 fortunes in IndyCar. Britain's Alex Lloyd is the highest placed rookie, and Hideki Muto the highest placed local driver. Today's race from Japan is the penultimate leg in what has been a terrific season's racing, and last week the IRL CEO Randy Barnard announced the schedule for 2011. This is where they're going next year. Plenty to look forward to in 2011, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to be a great year by the look of it. Las Vegas, we tacked on the end there, Johnny, because hasn't been actually confirmed yet, but it looks like Las Vegas is going to be the place that we're going to wind up at the end of the year.
I think it's an important place to have a race, to be honest, and I've raced there a couple of times, albeit we haven't been there for a long, long time in the series that I race in, and I think that for IndyCar, more often than not, it's just NASCAR that goes there, it's king, and I think for IndyCar to go back there because of the history involved with the race would be awesome.
Are you a betting lady, Pippa?
I'm not a betting lady, but if I was, my money would be on Vegas. I know that Randy Barnard has been trying really, really hard to make that race happen, and we think he's getting fairly close. It hasn't officially been announced yet. It's still between Vegas and Fontana, but most of us think it's going to end up in Vegas.
Let's take a look then at the confirmed items, and there's a lot of changes this year, of course. Gone are Kansas, Watkins Glen, Chicagoland, and Homestead. They're all gone. In are Milwaukee, New Hampshire, and Baltimore, a street race around Baltimore. And with Las Vegas looking the likely season finale. Another point of interest, the Indy 500 is round 5 next year, of course, breaking a 4-round street track run, but still in the traditional month of May. So plenty to look forward to in 2011. You can see Motegi is still there in September, and we end up with 3 ovals to complete the season, which may please the like of Dario Franchitti again. But of course, oval-wise, it's been quite exciting this year for Dan Weldon in the closing stages. Johnny, I've got to say, Dan Weldon has been a man that's been looking for some results, and he's found some at last.
I think it was tough with him, especially seeing he's not had a teammate. Obviously, occasionally he has odd teammates coming in and out, but to be honest, that's not really going to help him. But for Dan, it would have been important to have a strong teammate and really build the team up, and he's done really well towards the end of the year.
And this is the scene, Pippa, of his first ever IRL win, so it has happy memories. So he might be on a bit of a roll here.
He does have happy memories, and he and the entire Panther team is on a bit of a roll at the moment. They had some really good cars in Chicagoland, and arguably they had the best cars out there in Kentucky. I saw Dan and Ed after the race, and I know they were both absolutely gutted to come home second and third. You know, Helio won it, ended up being a fuel mileage race, and they were just both distraught, especially because it was a tactic they felt Penske got forced into almost due to bad luck in an earlier pit stop. They almost got forced into taking the tactic they did, and so they were just... yeah, absolutely, just couldn't believe neither of them had won the race. So they're really on a roll, they're looking strong, and hopefully Dan will bring home a good result this weekend.
Fingers crossed for Dan then, and Panther of course. 25 cars have made the trip to Japan, and after qualifying, here's how they line up on the 1.5 mile oval. It's a 201 mile per hour Penske lockout at the front. Elio Castroneves has picked up a crucial point for pole position. Ryan Briscoe starts beside him. Series leader Will Power and defending champion Dario Franchitti can't be separated on row 2. Marco Andretti and Tony Kanaan are on row 3. Ryan Hunter-Reay and EJ Vizo row 4. Dan Weldon is having a great finish to his year, but he's got work to do from row 5. Takuma Sato is the best of the local drivers. Scott Dixon and Danica Patrick are on row 6. Bertrand Baguette and Vito Mira are on row 7. Alex Lloyd and Graham Rahal row 8. Row 9 sees Hideki Muto and Justin Wilson together. It's an all-Brazilian row 10 of Rafa Matos and Mario Moraes. Roger Yazakawa and Paul Tracy are on row 11. Alex Tagliani and Simona Di Silvestro, row 12. And Milka Duno brings up the rear. That's our lineup for round 16. After the break, we've race highlights from Motegi, the only IndyCar oval track in Japan and the venue for some eventful races in recent years.
Scott Dixon, his fifth win of the season.
Boys, move over. The lady is coming through. Danica Patrick wins a twin ring Motegi.
Time now for high-speed track action from Japan. We join our commentators Bob Jenkins, John Beekhouse and Robbie Buell for the start of the Indy Japan 300 from Twin Ring Motegi in Japan.
Two drivers, two races remain. This week, the road to the championship takes us to a world away. Motegi, Japan. Through 15 races this season, the points lead has changed twice, and only between these two drivers. Will Power started this season from the front, and he's dominated the summer stretch of road courses. Heading into the final four races, which are all on ovals, his lead was 59 points. But a Franchitti win in Chicago diminished his lead to 23 points. Paired with an eighth place finish in Kentucky left Will Power only 17 points ahead of defending champion Dario Franchitti. Today, in the land of the rising sun, Will Power must rise to the occasion on this oval opportunity of Motegi. A win here for Power would silence his critics, but a victory for Franchitti could prove costly to this season's rising star. The Izod IndyCar Series has made its annual trek to the land of the rising sun, and today the Indy Japan 300 brings the battle for the season championship one step closer to being settled. It's the eighth appearance of the Izod IndyCar Series here at Twin Ring Motegi. Let's go down for the command.
Ladies and gentlemen, start your engines!
Now that was an enthusiastic trucker start your engines,
that
wasn't
was
it?
That was a good start. I like
it
that
sure
start.
It sure was. Well, the cars do fire to life here. We've got 25 drivers set to go. And here's a look at the starting grid, which contains five former winners here. While you take a look at the lineup. We'll give you a few facts. Two drivers, Danica Patrick and Dan Weldon, won their first series races here. Four events have been won from the pole position. The most recent was just last year by Scott Dixon. 11 of the 25 drivers in the field have led laps here at Motegi. Dixon has led the most laps. The most lead changes we ever had here was 13 in 98 and in 03, and the most leaders, 7. That occurred three times in 98, 02, and 05. And only once has the race winner gone on to win the championship in the same year, and that was Dan Weldon in 2005. So something for both Dario Franchitti and Will Power to keep in mind as the cars begin to pull away now. They will get the green flag the third time by the start-finish line. As we have indicated, this is kind of an odd-shaped racetrack. Turns one and two are rather wide, but it's a much tighter radius when the cars get to turns three and four. And we have seen drivers, in fact, shift down two gears as they enter turn number three. Onboard cameras will be carried by Hideki Muto, whose father is in the grandstand today and watching his son in an IZOD IndyCar Series race for the very first time. There's Hideki as he warms up the Firestone Firehawks, getting ready to go. Danica Patrick is hoping for a repeat from 2 years ago when she captured the hearts of millions of race fans in taking her first victory.
Sounds good. Get a little bit of heat.
Takuma Sato racing in his home country for the first time since the Formula One 2007 Japanese Grand Prix. Dan Weldon, the only two-time winner here. He's never finished worse than eighth. Ryan Hutter-Reay, whose string of eight straight top 10 finishes was broken 2 weeks ago at Kentucky. And Tony Kanaan, who is the only driver to compete in all of the open wheel races that have been held here, and he won the event in 2007. Here's the race strategy opinion from Jack Arute.
Fellows, we all know it's going to take about three pit stops. You may short fill on one depending on the number of cautions. But I think the determining factor that all these strategists are going to have to deal with is the weather. We've talked about it since we went on the air. This is the hottest ambient temperature that an IndyCar race in the IZOD IndyCar Series has ever contested here in Japan. Track temperature-wise, it's also hotter. The record previous to this was set back in 2005 in April. So what does that mean, fellas? Well, Robbie and Jan, you know, you're going to have to twist on the cars, taking a look at putting wing in, taking wing out, and tire pressure choices during the pit stops will help compensate for the ever-escalating temperatures.
And Jack, of course, when you did that interview with Danica Patrick, she really laid out a very good point. You don't really want to change the car, Robbie, prior to the start, but as soon as you get a feel for it, you might want to be looking for adjustments.
Yeah, she used the word consistency, and I think that's going to be the key. You want to have a consistent car. And remember, you got your onboard tools with the weight jacker and bars.
Former winners here at Twin Ring Motegi, which also includes a road course. Adrian Fernandez won twice. The two-time winner Dan Weldon is in today's field. Michael Andretti, also a former winner here, as is Elio, Kanaan, Patrick, and Scott Dixon. Great crowd on hand. We were noticing just while Jack was doing some of his pre-race activity how the crowd filled in very, very nicely. I think this may be the largest crowd ever at this place.
The way they wrap around turns one and two and go all the way around,
yeah.
I think that's as full as it's ever been.
Holiday weekend certainly has made a big difference. Now the race, of course, being on Sunday in Japan.
Right. Okay, well, the cars begin to line up two by two now as we get set for the start of the Indy Japan 300. Team Penske sweeping the first three qualifying positions. Off of corner number four they come. And the Apex Brazil green flag is waving, and Elio gets in front of his teammate as they go to turn number one.
Rafael Matos, blue and silver, actually got below the line and back up again. What a great start.
Wow.
And did you watch the guys, the 1-2-3 all slotted in right by start finish line, and then that game changed.
Dario just got power.
And look at that, is Marco in the red and black car on the high side of power.
Man, he is way up high.
Power's dropping back.
And look at Marco.
Remember what his plan, though. Just because he's dropping back now, he's just maybe being a little bit cautious. He's got that championship on his mind.
Dan Weldon also passing by Scott Dixon. We're on board with Danica Patrick. And we have a yellow in turn number two.
And it looks like it's Bertrand Baguette. Boy, we have paid so many compliments to Bertrand because of his adaptation, if you will, to the ovals.
Well, and just what he did last weekend.
Yeah.
You know, as you said, he qualified in the top 10, finished in the top 10. And I was just about to say, this is really a tricky track the first couple laps, because one and two, there's some pretty big bumps there. You got about three different grooves you can run. You get up in that high groove where it gets dirtier just because people are checking up. You kind of think, oh, I can get up here. But that section usually gets some folks caught out. So you're building that pressure and temperature in the tires, and that was only our second time by.
Bertrand was coming off his best finish of the year. He came in 10th at Kentucky after his best start of the year. He lined up in the third row.
And Robbie, I know you've lived it. If your car is too low and if you crash across that bump, it is a long day. And of course, we get this post the bump. The bump is about in the middle of the corner. We don't know if he's been chasing it since the bump, but you say when the car's heavy and the pressures are low, it really tags the ground.
Yeah, thanks for clarifying that. I mean, just that's that you're going to hammer the ground all that much more, just like we saw Dixon do when he had that downforce, extra downforce in the car, just put that thing down there. Good to see him moving.
Yeah.
And where we just saw him clip the wall, that's coming off a two. So it really is, we may say, oh boy, that looks like it was further in the corner, but things happen so fast with doing 200 miles an hour through there. That probably happened close to the middle portion of the corner where that biggest bump is in between one and two, and just kind of slid straight across.
Baguette walks to the ambulance. He looks to be in good shape. He'll be checked over, but it has brought the first caution flag out here at Twin Ring Motegi. As Will Power looking for his championship, and Dario Franchitti hoping to upset Will Power's points lead going into this race. We are under caution here at Twin Ring Motegi because of a crash that involved Bertrand Baguette.
Yeah, it's a good job, mate, being steady and careful. No one could run up out of the groove on those opening laps anyway.
And what you're hearing from is Nick Harvey, because every other race this year, Roger Yasukawa has been the spotter for Takuma Sato, but he's driving today.
Yeah.
So Nick Harvey is taking over those spotter duties.
And Nick Harvey's no stranger to that. He's been an engineer. He's been a strategist. I mean, he's really worked around.
Both your cars just pitted, Robbie.
Again, and that's just a top-off. These are all the guys in the back of the queue. Nothing crazy here. Just topping off, trying to extend that fuel window.
And Robbie, that's exactly precisely the reason, if you look at the starting positions of the guys that did pit, like Wilson, like Paul Tracy, like Tagliani, it makes sense because you make about 8 miles to the gallon under caution. Running these caution laps, checking with the telemetry, you can kind of figure now that when you go back to green, you've got maybe three, maybe to as many as five additional laps outside the window, so you can push it a little further, so you don't have to worry about things. If you're in the back, you pit, you're still going to be in the back.
And we have another angle of the replay of Baguette's problem on board with Takuma. Yep.
Yeah, you see everybody sparking, so that means, you know, you're hitting a little harder than you'd like because you're still building pressure in those tires. And do you notice he was on the higher side of the racetrack as well?
Paul Tracy makes another pit stop and tops off.
Like Jack just said, you know, you just keep coming in. If you're at the back and you come in, you're still at the back, but you got some more fuel, so you
That's
can
right.
go a little bit longer, which plays favor in terms of pushing that pit window.
And the person who leads right now obviously put that little pit tactic to very good use at the last
very
race.
Very good at Kentucky, yes, sir.
Sometimes that does really pay.
But as we're thinking back and talking about Elio with that pick tactic, it wasn't part of the plan. They had a little miscue,
yep.
So they had to shift the plan. And because of that miscue, that plan shift is what won that race.
Yep. Good call by Roger Penske, and a great in-color interview there with Roger Penske and Chip Ganassi in our pre-race show. At the top of the screen, you can see the running order. It's Castroneves, Briscoe, Franchitti, Andretti. Will Power drop back to fifth position. Marco Andretti has moved up nicely. Actually, the driver gaining the most positions in the opening laps was Milka Duno, who gained six positions. Mario Marais 5, Matos, Dixon, and DeSilvestro all gained 3 positions as we're on board with Weldon.
And there with Weldon, we just saw the tire marks of turn 2 where Bertrand went in. And that definitely was in the middle portion of that corner where those bumps are, and off he went.
Yep.
Hey, Bob, they have a special decal on the car you're looking at, and that, of course, is Roger Yasukawa, who was born in L.A., speaks fluent Japanese, and is cheered on equally, along with Takuma Sato and, of course, Hideki Muto. But on the nose of the car, there is a good luck sticker. Joshua Hall, who is a staff sergeant in the 19th National Guard Unit 3, his unit is being dispatched to Afghanistan, and Joshua's brother is one of the crew members on this team. As a surprise to Joshua and to his brother, the team had the decal made. It rides on the nose, and it wishes Joshua Godspeed and thanks him for his service to our country.
Wow, very nice. Yeah, Roger Yasukawa is a Native American, but he is of Japanese descent. And right now he finds himself back in 22nd position, driving for Conquest Racing this year, or this week, I should say, as Elio Castroneves has the field stacked up behind him. And as we come down for lap number 11, we will get the green flag and an Apex Brazil green flag restart. Here we go.
Oh, look at Dario.
Franchitti looking for second position, dives to the inside of Briscoe and gets a half a car length ahead.
And everybody in that top group, say 7 cars, when I looked over the mile, they were all pushing their overtake button. It was lit up green on our board.
Oh, Briscoe's coming back.
Coming back. Now you got to get it up alongside. He's alongside to get into 3.
Wow. Whoa, look out.
Man,
that,
man.
That's a single groove track through there. I mean, you can go side by side because we just saw it.
And now Dario has the momentum, can chop him off and get it back.
Okay, so Briscoe, be patient here. Just set him up to get a good run off of 2 and dive back underneath him into 3.
They're both on the button right now. Okay, they're so both on the overtake.
This is just what he did before. He came down the inside and they went through side by side when the fast way is one car by himself, and Briscoe got it now.
Wow. Good stuff. Early in the going.
He's coming back.
Here comes Dario back on the inside.
And where the pass all starts for that turn 3 entry really is coming off of turn 4. It's when you can go back to full power coming off of 4. 1 and 2, you're just flat out and trying to be as free as you can with the car.
But watch the way they go down into come off of turn number 2. That's the end result right there as you're watching, out of 3 and through 4. At the driver's meeting, they discussed, and you're Dario talking, and TK's talking about just how much all the blocking routine's going to be allowed to do. When you go down into the corner, see Ryan Briscoe, he elects to stay down on the white line. They told him that if you do that, you can drift up half a lane, but you can't impede the car behind you. That was some nifty action between those two drivers, showing a lot of respect and adhering to the rules Brian Barnhart outlined in the driver's meeting.
That little battle has broken off for second position, and while Dario and Ryan were battling for second position, Elio got himself a rather comfortable lead here, pulling out to about a 1.3 second advantage. The top 5, Castroneves, Briscoe, Franchitti, Andretti, and Kanaan, with 14 laps completed.
With us here in the studio are Pippa Mann and, of course, Johnny Molum as well. Pippa, it certainly looks to me like Dario was looking for that second position, but what he was risking at that point seemed to be a lot.
Yeah, Dario was really going after that position with Briscoe. They were racing each other really hard for this early in the race. There's a long way to go yet, and Dario's still got his championship to focus on, so now he's just slotted back in behind him, and he looks like he's following him around for a little bit now.
Elio Castroneves out front, Johnny. Dario Franchitti in a good position with Will Power back there in 6th place at the moment. Just the kind of stat that he'll want to be seeing.
Absolutely, and what looks slightly worrying to me is that Elio Castroneves seems to be able to pull away without a slipstream, and so he's obviously got a very, very strong car, so I suspect that getting around him might be quite tough, and as you saw, Dario's struggling to get around Briscoe, so if he's going to get around the 2 in front of him, it could be a tall order.
Interesting scenario, Pippa, that Penske, you wonder at what point in this race they might be assisting Will Power.
Well, that'll be something that will come up maybe later on in the race, but at the moment, Will's dropped back a little bit at the start. He's obviously being fairly cautious, and he's back behind 2 Andretti cars, as well as Dario between himself and Briscoe. So at the moment, even if Penske were trying to help him out, there's not a lot they can do. Will just needs to settle in, get himself back up to speed, get back around those Andretti cars and start knocking on the door again.
Well, a lot of potential winners here today. Early stages yet, Johnny?
Very much so, and we were in car a little bit earlier with Takuma Sato, so I'm really hoping that he manages to actually finish this race. So looking good at the moment, a little bit processional, but I'm sure it'll get exciting and side-by-side racing a little bit later on. And also as their tyre temperatures come back in, you'll see less sparking as their ride heights raise up slightly.
Well, this is the penultimate round then of the 2010 IndyCar Series, and Elio Castroneves starts from pole and leads the Indy Japan 300 at Twin Ring Motegi. Ryan Briscoe, who qualified in second place, is in second place, but all eyes are on Dario Franchitti in third place. Can the Scotsman score big points today?
Back at Twin Ring Motegi for the Indy Japan 300. A battle here between Dan Weldon and Ryan Hunter-Reay, and that is for ninth position, and Weldon will take it.
So he's calling in. And you could tell he had too much push because he's working his way up the racetrack. And boy, when he got pushed up a little bit by Weldon and caught that bump, boy, it got a big wiggle, Robbie.
And when the car's got too much push, when it's got too much push, you got to wait to get on the throttle. It's going up the racetrack, and if you go with more power, you're just going to pick yourself right up into that wall. So you have to wait on that car to turn more before you can get to power. And remember, the key to the pass in turn three is how you get to the power coming off of turn four.
Guys, you checked in with David Cripps, who's calling the shots for Dan Weldon. They like their race car, but Dan Weldon says it's a little bit slow down the straightaway. Guys, isn't that generally an indicator that maybe you've added just a little bit too much downforce?
But not a bad thing. You know, Jack, the conditions of it being the hottest race we've ever had here, and when it gets hot like there, the track gets greasy, so probably not a bad call. Let's be patient. There's a lot of racing to go. Let's see how that car is as you get to the last 50 laps.
Danica Patrick on board with her right now, looking back to Weldon. She has gained four positions since the drop of the green flag, but Rafael Matos has gained sixth positions, went from 19th to 13th, and Mario Marias has also gained six positions since the drop of the green.
You could hear her going up through the gears. That's because usually at this pace of the race, you go down two gears. There she just went up one. She'll hit sixth gear either here, right there, just on the approach to turn number one, hold it all the way around. You can see on the telemetry, and if she doesn't have someone ahead of us, she'll go down to fourth gear, pow, down for turn number three.
Top speed, probably 207. Yep, just saw up to 207. Dumping the throttle and dropping your two gears.
There you are. In traffic, sometime you might go to third, but that's really only if you get bottled up.
And that area where you're dropping those two gears, where we saw Danica drop the gears, here you're flat out six gear. You got three different lanes you can really run over in one and two. But as you get into that three and four, that really is the place that everybody's been fighting. They say, oh, my car's pushing. You make a couple changes to the car, it gets loose. I mean, that's where the key to this race is going to be, using your bars and your jacker in the cockpit, as well as changes to the balance of that race car throughout your stops.
Wow, look at Danica's laps from 193 up to over 195.
Which you would think would be awesome until you see that Castroneves has done a 199.
Right.
Which is, that's almost qualifying pace.
Yeah, but that last time back at 195, that's the pace that Briscoe, who's running at P2, that's what he's run. So, you know, Danica's got a pretty well-balanced car. We know she likes his racetrack.
Franchitti continues to run in third position. He's about 4 seconds behind the leader of the race. Elio leads, Ryan Briscoe running second, and Dario is third.
Will's definitely hungry for it, as am I, to get a third championship. His team has a lot of experience, and they can guide him. But he's been doing a very good job, and he's a tough adversary. But I'm hopeful we can get him.
He, of course, talking about Will Power, who is the points leader coming into Motegi, and with only one more race to go after this one, can Franchitti pull off a two-year in a row championship? After taking that year off to run NASCAR, he has come back to the Izod IndyCar Series with a vengeance, hasn't he?
Well, he's not only going to have to contend with Will Power, he's going to have to contend with that guy who's Will Power's teammate. Elio Castroneves has made it very clear in all the pre-prep for this race that they're out there to do everything they can to bring Team Penske that championship, and the guy that's driving that is Will Power. So Dario's got to go against Briscoe, Elio, and Power.
And this is the sixth race of the year that Elio has led, four on ovals and two on road courses. He has led since the drop of the green flag here this afternoon in Motegi. And we have completed 29 laps. We're on lap number 30. Briscoe about 2.5 seconds behind. Franchitti, Andretti, Cannon, the top five. Then Power, Dixon, Patrick Weldon, and Ryan Hunter-Reay.
Elio Castroneves making it look easy at just under 200 mile an hour a lap as he goes through some lap traffic at the minute. Pepperman, got to say that Elio at the minute looks imperious.
Yeah, his car looks really, really good at the moment, but he is starting to catch up to the lap traffic and starting to have to work his way through cars, as is everyone else. So we'll see what his car looks like in dirty air when he comes up behind more than one car at once and has to start working his way around.
Dario Franchitti still third, Will Power still sixth. Those are the two we're looking at for the championship, of course. Danik Patrick in eighth place, Dan Weldon in ninth at the moment, Johnny. You can't separate those two, can you, especially at this place?
Well, they've got their love-hate relationship still going on, haven't they? But I noticed there that Dan looked to be able to be coming through turn four a little bit quicker than Danica. But her car's looking pretty hooked up at the moment. It'll be interesting to see how they manage to keep that throughout the whole race. But I think Elio Castroneves is looking incredibly strong, surprisingly strong actually at this point.
Quick throwaway question, Pippa, since we've got you here for the first time. Danica Patrick obviously is, the lady, I suppose, in IndyCars. Emulate that, perhaps?
I'm just hoping to make my own way. I am hoping to be an IndyCar next year. But the thing with Danica that lots of people tend to forget is she actually does a really good job. Last year she was the top non-Penske, non-Ganassi driver. And this year she's looking to finish in the top 10 of one of the toughest championships in the world again. So, you know, she does a great job.
She certainly does. Let's go back to the Indy 300.
After today, one race remains. Be sure to join us here on Versus for the Cafés do Brasil Indy 300 from Homestead Miami Speedway, Saturday night, October 2nd at 6 o'clock Eastern. You know how tight the points battle is going in. We'll know in a couple of hours how it is going out, but it will be the final event Saturday, October 2nd, 6 Eastern here on Versus. And as you know, Lindy and Robbie Floyd are at their homes chatting and tweeting with you fans. And our poll results on Versus.com indicates that you race fans think that Will Power is going to win the championship. He has a 37-27% lead over Dario, so there you go. What do you guys think?
I wouldn't bet against Power.
It'd be pretty tough to, wouldn't it?
Yeah, again, just think about what he's done on the last two ovals at Chicago and Kentucky. I mean, the results haven't been there because of certain miscues. He can do it, but Dario mentally, he's doing all the chasing, and I think there's just a lot more pressure on Power being up front, don't you?
And speaking of Will Power, when we look back to find him, remember that you heard from Ryan Briscoe, his teammate, talking about when you come here for the first time, he's now run the course, he's qualified in the top three, but race conditions are much different, and he just doesn't have in his database, in his own personal database, what the car is going to feel like and how it's going to change during a race. So I think that's why he's dropped back. He's got to stay out of trouble.
But that's a good mental approach for the driver. Don't get yourself in trouble. Continue to learn about the track. You're in the championship hunt.
Simona Di Silvestro being lapped there. You saw her at the bottom of the racetrack. We are on board with Cannon, who is running in seventh position. I'm sorry, he is running in fifth, looking back to Will Power, who is in sixth. And there is Simona on the right part of your screen.
And a shout out to that team. Remember, she had another big accident at the last race. They've gone now to the third car of the year after also having a bad accident in Texas. And so they've got yet another tub, tried to put it together, but obviously it hasn't come together with much speed.
And at this racetrack, when you're off the pace and you're staying out of the groove, looking back from Weldon's car, Danica, but when you're off the pace and you're letting cars go by and you get off the groove, it's just insult to injury because you pick up more stuff on your tires and your car gets worse and worse. And it is absolutely no fun. And Simona's in a little bit of that window right now.
Uh-oh, that's Lloyd.
Alex Lloyd is slowing down dramatically and dives toward the bottom of the racetrack.
Just in time there as the leaders went by, didn't they?
Yeah.
And that looked like...
We saw Dan Weldon take eighth position from Danica Patrick before we went to this shot of Alex Lloyd, who is looks like coasting down the backstretch.
You know, well, I'll wait and see. Just wonder if he's lost the fire or whether he rubbed something.
Yeah. He was pretty way high on the racetrack going slow and then all of a sudden dove down in.
And Dario Franchitti, by the way, has gone to second, passing Ryan Briscoe.
And that's right what we saw when we saw him coming down pit road, when we saw Alex come down pit road. Those cars going side by side was the Penske and Franchitti car, and that was Franchitti getting by Briscoe.
I'm telling you, Dario is living up to what he has said, in that he's going out aggressively, not worrying about willpower.
And we will have a yellow because of the Alex Lloyd car, which apparently is not going to make it to pit lane.
And they will pit. But this is at the very early part of the window, so now you'll have a shakeup.
Yeah.
Here you were hoping to go longer, and now all of a sudden you may have to pit. Well, everyone will pit.
Yeah, on an oval like this,
yellow,
you get
pit.
You get hammered if you try and chance it for a green. Everybody's going to come
but
in.
What I'm saying, though, is that, yes, you all pit, but you also are just sneaking inside the window of two more stops after that, so then you have to start thinking, Do I save fuel or do I go for it?
I was going to say, when do you say I want to play the game of saving fuel? Because you're going to have to with this being the front end of that first pit win.
So this will shake it up.
Honda pace car picks up the leader, Elio Castroneves. And as you saw on pit lane, everybody is laid out, getting set for the first round of pit stops. We're on lap number 42, or rather completed lap number 42 on lap number 43.
The window was going to open at 44, but by the time you pit, run a couple laps under yellow, it'll be just about what you want.
And the pits aren't open yet, so it'll be another lap before they can come in.
That helps.
Yep.
But again, even though you say that window starts at 44, Jan, you still want to go as deep as you can in it. Yes, that's the opening of the window, but that's not the best scenario.
It's not the premium spot.
No.
There is Roger Yasukawa in car number 36, the second car from Conquest Racing, although the other Conquest car crashed out early with Bertrand Bargett.
Now, we should also remember, when you have everyone pitting at the same time, that is when you can make or break positions on pit lane, and that's when you can have incidents. And when you're running for a championship, remember how many things have happened this year on pit road. Mm-hmm. Be good to keep our eyes open for the entire field because they'll all hit at the same time.
Yeah, from the driver's standpoint, you would think their heart rate's up the most when they're on the track. Actually, it's at this point right now because it's not in their hands anymore. When they get that thing parked in the box, it's out of their hands and their heart rate goes up.
This is going to be good.
Wow, look at the scramble to get onto pit lane and define your pit box. Wow, Jack.
Elio Castroneves hits his pit mark as Dario Franchitti goes to his. Now they'll just change the tires and fill the car with fuel. These are 45-foot wide pit boxes, so there's plenty of room. Fuel is in. He's being chased by his teammate, Ryan Briscoe, and they almost connect, guys, as they get to the end of pit road.
But Power picked up one. Yep. Briscoe picked up and got by Franchitti.
And Elio was just a foot ahead of Briscoe as they
just
crossed
barely.
That timing line. Did you see that?
So Elio will maintain the lead here in our second caution of the afternoon for Alex Lloyd's stalled car on the racetrack. Back in a moment on Versus. Under caution here at Twin Ring Motegi with 47 laps completed. Alex Lloyd's car stalled on the racetrack. And we had some very close quarters coming off of pit lane because everybody came in for a pit stop. And here was the battle off of the pit road.
When you see Elio drop, right behind him, Briscoe drops a fraction ahead. And you can see how you have to thread the needle there. And from the front, you get a great angle of how you have to shoot the gap. Briscoe really tried. He nearly gets by his teammate on the high side. And we're back to a restart.
And green flag, and here we go once again. The most laps that Elio has led in a single race this year was 43 at Iowa when he finished in second position. Today he has led from the drop of the green, so he has led 48 and counting as we pick up in a battle in the middle of the pack. That's E.J. Viso, and right behind her, Milka Duno. And Vitor Merah coming to the inside of Milka, and man, did they get close. This is Sato.
All right, Michael, settle in nicely.
15th.
Lots of coaching from upstairs. That was a bar change. He took his left hand off, and you can change the anti-roll bars front rear. Look at the momentum he's got right now.
And that's the same when he got that left hand and went down. That's where the front bar and the rear bar all together.
He's going after Ray Hall.
He's inside him.
Got him. It's Alex Taglioni behind Graham.
Just after Nick Harvey finished telling him, let's settle down. And he's like,
I'm going to get him. Yeah, but there's some drivers, a spotter's going to say that all race long. That's what they're going to say all race long.
Look at
that.
This.
Tracy.
That's Tracy up on the high side of.
It didn't work, as we noticed that.
That didn't work.
Got up in the gray a little bit there, had to get out of the throttle. Well, Sato has absolutely been impressive with being on his home turf and all the pressure that goes with that. He had a crash. There's Justin the bars again. So he's working the bars every lap. He goes down, and usually when you're pulling the bar back like he just did, he's softening it as he goes through one and two, and there he stiffens it. So he stiffens it back up, it looks like, as you go into three. And when you're stiffened, it just holds the car up because it rolls in there more. So that's probably the scenario he's working those bars on.
There are some people that do the weight jacker and the bars at each end of the course every single lap because they're so different. And look how tight these quarters are with Taglioni now on the high side.
And Marias on the bottom.
And that's okay to be on that high side, but don't get up out of that groove. You get up out of that groove where we saw Tracy, it didn't work. Alex Taglioni, he was on the high side, but he didn't get all the way out of the darker shaded pavement where it gets slipped.
Taglioni has taken over 16th from Marias. There is Milka Duno. Now she is a lap down to the field, running in 21st position. So this is not a battle for position, as once again Sato makes an adjustment.
Yeah, and like you said, Jan, every lap there's guys that are doing stuff with the jacker or the bars. And every time that Sato goes into turn three, he stiffens up that bar.
Fellas, when Takuma Sato went out to qualify yesterday, there was a fairly decent crowd here, and I don't understand Japanese, but the call when he qualified in the seventh position, do you remember the excitement at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway from that large crowd when Elio Castroneves won the pole position after having to go out and win it back, and the way people were screaming and yelling? That's exactly what happened here for a seventh place qualifying posting for Takuma Sato. When he got out of the car, guys, you would have thought they were going to hand him the Borg Warner Trophy.
Well, you know, Robbie Buell was one of those that was jumping up and down because we talked this morning that was a, for the amount of time he had in the car, that was a fantastic effort.
Well, when he had that qualifying, we were on board on the in-car camera, and he had such a big save in lap one there, and usually when that happens, you back way off. No, he stayed right with it, and like you said, Jack, when they announced that he was in P7, they went crazy. Well, he drove his butt off to get that.
Elio Castroneves continues to lead by about a second and a half over his teammate Ryan Briscoe, and he has also turned in the fastest lap of the race on lap number 13 at almost 200 miles an hour. Now, the maximum G's they pull here, 3.8 or more.
Or more.
Yes.
We've heard both, haven't we?
Yeah. Anyway, Briscoe is in second, Franchitti third, then Kanaan and Marco Andretti in the Indy Japan 300. We are under caution again here at Twin Ring Motegi as Paul Tracy rubbed the wall, brushed it, and we can see what happened in the replay. Here it is. Ooh, way up out of the groove.
Second time that we've seen him up there today. He saved it earlier, but this time does not. You see the barrier move.
And it was a good save. He was even, the rear of the car was coming around. He was coming up there. It wasn't just a four-wheel drift up there. It was coming around.
Now, unfortunately, Matos and Muto just got cooked.
Yes.
Yeah,
they
right.
made their pit stops. Now there's been a caution. Yeah. The strategy just blew up.
Yeah, they needed it to stay green, and that group that's on the yep. track stay out there and cycle in. With it staying
yeah,
green.
So there that backfired.
Pit start.
Good. I liked it for a while.
Yeah.
I'd do it. It was the right call.
Pits are still closed. Now remember, during the last series of pit stops, Will Power gained several positions, and Danica Patrick also picked up one position during her pit stop. So we'll see how things go again as here comes the field.
Wow, look at Castro Neves just getting as close as he possibly can. You can't overtake, but you can get alongside.
Here's Jack.
And guys, here's what you have to watch now. Do you hit your marks exactly correctly? Ryan Briscoe, Dario Franchitti, they are all in. And you see those marks? You want to hit them exactly right. Now the teams go to work. They want to add 22 gallons of fuel, change the fire truck. Look at this drag race. They come, and look who's gained a lot of spots, Danica Patrick. A good wow. run by her and her team yet again. I think that moves her into fourth, but I'm no mathematician.
You are correct.
That is it.
Elio gains one and gets the lead back, and Danica will come back in fourth position, but we believe, I don't think that Muto and Matos pitted that time, did they? So they stayed out again.
Yeah, they would have stayed out because they've yeah, already yeah. come in and got their right. their fuel, what they do about 12 laps ago.
Yep. Okay, we'll take another break from the action at the Indy Japan 300 at Twin Ring Motegi here on Versus. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
And here in the Sky Sports studio are Pippa Mann and Johnny Molum. Johnny, if I can come to you first, a lot to be won down pit road. That was crucial, Castro Neves getting back in front there.
Yeah, I thought that was excellent. Elio showing his experience there, and also Dario keeping really tucked in close behind Elio. And interesting that Elio obviously passed him in the pits. That could actually be quite critical, because obviously with the Penske cars being so evenly matched, to actually pass out on the track is going to be a lot harder than it is just the way it happened just there in the pit lane. So he'll be happy.
Every year when we come back here, Pippa, this track always looks so flat to me. How difficult is it to drive a flat oval like this?
It's very, very difficult. The track only has about 11 degrees of banking, which is almost nothing. And the other thing that's very tricky about this track is that turns one and two are easy flat out. Turn three and four, much, much, much tighter corner. You actually have to downshift on the way in. That really unsettles the back of the car. So it's a very difficult track to drive.
And driving in traffic?
Driving in traffic as well, because turn three and four is so tight and you have to downshift and the cars get loose. It can make life pretty interesting for some of these drivers if they catch someone at just the wrong place in the corner.
Right now, all the action's been down in pit road as we have our third caution of the afternoon. Paul Tracy just gently rubbing the wall, but it looks like the end of the day for him at the moment. Dario Franchitti, I mean, he's got his eyes, I would imagine, Johnny, as much in his mirror as he's got looking forward.
I don't know. I think with Dario, I mean, the one thing that Dario's always had going for him is he's highly intelligent in the way he reads a race and the way he lets a race come to him, also the way he develops his car throughout a race. And I suspect that he's feeling pretty confident right now, not just because he's ahead of Will Power, which is ultimately what obviously you're suggesting with looking in his mirror, but more importantly, he's looking like he's really working his car towards the front, keeping on the lead lap, right up with the leaders, and his car's obviously working pretty well, but it doesn't seem to be working quite as well as Elio's car. That's the only downside.
Well, a fourth win of the series would be something pretty special as far as he's concerned. He was in Monza last week at the Formula One round, of course, having a good old wander round there, Pippa, and doing a good job for IndyCar. IndyCar suddenly has become a European thing again. We had Randy Bernard, that was the CEO, wandering about looking for new people to join him in the market. Dario Franchitti over here giving it a full bore on the BBC as well, which is always good for the sport.
Well, IndyCar has a great spread of drivers, and it is the only championship in the world where you have to master both disciplines equally. You have to be able to master road and streets and ovals. And next year, with the diverse schedule, you've got short ovals, super speedways, road courses and street courses. So it's actually four different disciplines you have to master to win one title.
It still amazes me that Dario Franchitti, the man that looks like today, if he gets a good finish, he's going to win the oval championship, of course, the AJ Foyt oval championship. We've got three categories going on, the overall championship, the oval championship and the street track championship that's been won already by Will Power. When he first came along, he didn't like ovals that much.
Well, he wasn't brought up on them, so, you know, it makes a massive difference if it's not something you've been brought up in terms of the technique that you use to adapt to ovals, being it so completely different to road courses.
Well, this is caution three, as you can see, from the Indy 300 in Japan, the Indy Japan 300. Helio Castroneves is back out front. Everybody is chasing the Penske man once again. Let's get back to our commentators at the track.
Will Power, of course, where he wants to be relative to the day.
Yep. Yeah, Dixon, I mean, you know, he wasn't happy with his qualifying, but he seems to be keeping tuning on that car.
Tony Kanaan running in seventh position. And right behind him, another member of the Andretti Autosport team, Ryan Hutter-Reay, and Dan Weldon is ninth, and Marco Andretti is in 10th position as we have another Apex Brazil restart. And look at the jump that Dario got.
And watch Danica back there. I think she's even got more momentum if she has somewhere to go. On board with her, like I said, I think she had to breathe off the gas a little bit, but still's got a big run. But patient, don't force it. You can't force it.
Wait, there's a little bit of weaving going on there.
Yeah, do you see the movement from Briscoe's car? That was just, it was like it was all loose. Loose. Moving around loose back there, but in control.
Here is Kanaan looking for a position from Will Power and trying to get sixth.
Yeah, but what we've seen before is right here. You take off to the races. We think he's got less downforce. And look at Ryan Hutter-Reay making him a sandwich.
Oh, this boy.
Clear heads prevailed for Ryan Hutter-Reay. He had the momentum. He said, wait a minute. Great call to have that presence.
Biometrics on Robbie Buell on that one.
Yeah. Well, it all happens so quick.
That's good.
Look at he's got to run again. So just again, patience. Just set it back up and wait for the right time to strike.
Outside the top 10, Graham Rahal in 11th, EJ Viso in 12th, and home country favorite Takuma Sato is 13th. Vitor Mira 14th, Tagliani 15th. In case you missed our pre-race show, we did make the announcement that AJ Foyt the fourth and his wife Casey gave birth to AJ Foyt the fifth earlier tonight. So congratulations to the couple and to AJ.
Absolutely.
The first, second, third, fourth, and fifth.
Just on board there with Sato, what we talked about earlier, he's always going to changing those bars every time he goes into turn three, and then he comes off the four, pushing him the other way. He's still doing that, even with other changes they've made through pit stops. So that's something that is a dominant change that he does lap after lap.
Casey,
like two clicks with the bar there in terms of softening up.
I was just going to say, Casey, AJ Foyt's, AJ the fourth's wife, is the daughter of Ursay, who owns the Indianapolis Colts. Bob Ursay.
Hard to keep all those numbers straight, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Safe to say Anthony's a big Colts fan.
Yeah. Sato and Viso racing for the 12th spot.
Of course, Viso has played a part in Sato's setup because we've documented that Sato had that big crash right at the opening of practice and he needed to go to EJ Viso's setup and said that that really gave him the opportunity. That's why having multiple car team really helped.
Mm-hmm. And why that information was valuable to Sato, as EJ was pretty happy with his car as soon as they got on track. It wasn't though he was chasing his setup. He liked what he had, so that was a good thing for Sato, for EJ to be able to say, yeah, this is a good direction. Trust it.
But there's a lot of work going on in those cars when you consider that when you're not in traffic, you're going down two gears right here. Each straightaway, you're going, in his case, you're making a bar adjustment. And he can also be making weight jacker because sometimes they put those pedals on the back of the wheel. So there's a lot going on. It's not just riding around looking for a place to pass.
Yeah, forget about the fact you're doing 200 miles an hour right now and you're trying to chase that guy in front of you with all that other stuff going on in the cockpit.
There's the 14th car of Vitor Mira running in 14th position. Jack?
As you were talking about AJ the fourth, when he came here and ran for his granddaddy in 2003, he needed to go to an ATM machine. And a man, it was 16 years old, Tetsuo Karamuchi, not only provided him with directions, but took him to that ATM machine. He came to the race as a guest of AJ the fourth. And he became so enamored with the Foyt family that he has traveled back and forth to the United States. And to see the U.S. travels with the Foyt hauler. Well, he is here. You see him on the right-hand side of the screen here in his hometown, working yet again for AJ Foyt. And he was one of the guys most excited when he heard about the birth of AJ Foyt the fifth.
How about that? Good story, Jack. AJ did not make the trip to Japan, so he obviously is watching us tonight on Versus, and congratulations, great granddaddy. Okay, 133 laps completed out of 200 here at Twin Ring Motegi. It's Castroneves leading Franchitti and Briscoe.
Elio still out in front and still here in the studio with us, Pippa Mann and Johnny Molum. Now then, let's talk. I'm intrigued. Takuma Sato is changing his car almost every lap, it would seem, at the moment, Pippa.
Yes, in the Firestone Indy Lights cars and in the Indy cars, you can adjust your front anti-roll bar and your rear anti-roll bar from in the car. So because this track is so different through turns 1 and 2 to 3 and 4, it looks like Takuma is literally changing the settings on those bars for turns 1 and 2 and then again for turns 3 and 4 pretty much every lap. While he's in clean air, that's not a huge challenge, but now he's looking around traffic and trying to pass people. It's kind of something else he's got to remember and really think about the whole time too.
It's all very F1, Johnny.
Yeah, I mean, that's Takuma, isn't it? I mean, when you're driving in single seats, especially in Formula One now with all the gizmos, he'll be changing diff settings and all the rest of it regularly every lap. So he's probably used to that. But like Pippa says, when you're running two or three of you in worrying about losing front and rear aero at the same time, it can become a little bit interesting. So hopefully for his sake, he doesn't concentrate too much on that and make a mistake and end up not finishing this race.
Scott Dixon in fifth place there, Will Power behind him. I wonder if that's going to be significant as this race moves on, Johnny.
Yes, I mean, at the moment it's looking really good for Darrow for the championship. If it finished like this, he'd be very, very happy going into Miami. But I can't believe that Will's going to let this run away. I mean, whether he's being overly cautious or whether he's just been unlucky with traffic, it's obviously single groove around a few of these corners because of the light angle of the banking. So it's going to be interesting to see how he's going to make his way, if he can make his way back to the front.
Worth a shout there as well, going across the top of your screen. 19th place, Milka Duno, consistently having a good drive here.
Yeah, she seems to be having a fairly good day out there. So, you know, kudos to Milka, and hopefully she can keep doing a good job.
Simona Di Silvestro just a little bit further back. She's not really, she didn't qualify that well, and she's obviously struggling with the Japanese track. Twin Ring Motegi then we are looking at, and that's one of the Ganassi cars. And as we head back to our colleagues at trackside, this is the Indy Japan 300. From Twin Ring Motegi, good crowd turned out here today for the penultimate round of the IndyCar Series. Dario Franchitti is best placed at the moment for jumping up the order still further in the points. Let's go back to the track and rejoin our colleagues.
Elio Castroneves continues to lead here at Twin Ring Motegi. He had led a total of 90 laps all year coming into this race, and he has just led his 92nd lap this afternoon at Motegi, and he is about 3.5 seconds ahead of Dario Franchitti. Now, we talked about A.J. Foyt in the previous segment. The A.J. Foyt Oval Championship will be decided here this afternoon. It is not including the Homestead Miami race 2 weeks from now. So the championship of the ovals will be decided this afternoon. And right now, Elio has an 11-point spread over, or Dario has an 11-point spread over Elio as they run.
Where do you guys think the big momentum shift was for this guy right here? I just think of that call they made at Chicago to not change tires, which gave him the lead, obviously went on to win that race. Then what happened with Willpower? I mean, I think that was, you know, that was just the huge momentum switch, and that was a gamble, a risk call that paid off to create this.
And also, what a difference a year makes. When you look at that gap, when you look at the interval between Castro Neves, then back to Franchitti, and you have a good graphic example of that. Part of the reason there's been a flip-flop is there's a tire change, is that they continually evolve these Firestone tires, and the Target team had a setup that blew everybody away last year, but all it takes is a little sidewall construction change, and all of a sudden, that setup doesn't work anymore. Penske has pounced on it, and now they've got the setup to beat.
No question, because these guys right here, the Target Chip Ganassi cars, as you said, were dominant here last year, and they don't have that magic.
Yeah,
but they have.
And Briscoe has talked time and time again. He thinks the reason they were so aggressive and why he crashed on pit lane was they were taking risks because they needed to somehow find a way to beat the Target team because they were dominant. Now it's flip-flop completely.
Mm-hmm. And Elio, who's running away with everybody right now, I mean, he's hooked up out there.
Yeah.
But he gave a lot of credit to the whole team and the preparation before you came to this track, how they were prepared to say, we have to be better at Motegi this year, and they are.
Well, they figured out where their weak link was, and they fixed it.
Elio has clinched the 2 bonus points for leading the most laps at Motegi. That helps his teammate Willpower by taking points away from Dario. Now, we talked earlier in the show about how Dario will be going for back-to-back championships, and that has not happened very often. Only once in the Izon IndyCar Series history, Sam Hornish Jr. in 2001 and 2002, as we look at Marco Andretti, who has been running in or near the top 10 all afternoon, and he is currently in 10th. And look at the 4 Andretti Autosport drivers all in the top 10. Sam Hornish Jr., the only Izon IndyCar Series back-to-back champion, but it's happened several times in 40 years. Joe Leonard, Tom Sneva, Rick Mears, Bobby Rahal, Alex Zanardi, Gilles DeFerrin, and Sebastian Bourdais, who won 4 years in a row.
Andretti Autosport, just let's think back to Kentucky. They had all 4 of their cars finish in the top 10 there as well. So they have really done a great job of focusing improvement on these super speedways.
Marco running in 10th spot. Just a little more than 50 laps to go in the Indy Japan 300 that Elio Castroneves has by the... And we have a caution and a car in the wall.
And I think that's Lloyd.
I think it is, too.
Boy Scouts of America car.
Wow.
Off of turn 2.
Tough day for Alex, who caused a caution when the car suddenly stopped on him and he had to be towed in, but got going again, obviously, and now has made heavy contact with the right side of the car into the turn 2 safer barrier.
He's got a fire going on the side, similar to what we saw with Simona De Silvestro.
Originally, that fire starts just when the oil tank probably broke, got onto the headers, ignited that fire, and when that flame starts, it actually, the carbon catches on fire.
Now, the big difference here is what happened with Simona when that fire started to rage was the engine was still running, and Jack had done a piece on that saying it was continuing to run and pump oil. So it continued to run and pump oil and just feed the flames. This is more typical what you would see. You kind of nonchalantly come up and spray it out, and you're good to go. But that was a unique scenario earlier in the season.
And so with regards to strategy and stops now, we're at lap 148. Everybody's going to be able to come in right now, top off, and get to the end of this thing.
Yep. You don't need a complete full load of fuel, though. They'll need to really fill it up.
A full load. So, yeah. So a key after that is take advantage of that restart. You are going to have to time that thing, pounce on everything you can to gain position on that restart.
And Robbie, the thing you're going to want to watch during these pit stops, we talked about it and we don't talk about it enough. They put marks out on the pit stall. The driver has to hit those marks exactly correctly. Not necessarily to help the tire changers, but to get that fuel to seat properly. Remember what happened to Ryan Briscoe when they weren't able to get the seat right in the redhead and what it cost him. Not Ryan Briscoe, Will Power, that is. And that was where one of the momentum shifts in terms of points. So this pit stop, everybody's got to be bringing their A game.
Okay, here's the replays now of the Alex Lloyd crash.
Oh, that looks almost identical, except this time it looks like the front. Because the car did not turn at all. It almost like it let down on the front
but lost the
steering.
Yeah, big spark, and just went off at that diagonal of where it was sparking into the wall, didn't it?
I've done something similar, and that hurts.
Yeah, I can imagine. Now, here are the pit stops once again.
And like Jack said, you can't place enough emphasis on the importance of just hitting your marks, carrying momentum in. Don't slow up too quick. You can't give away anything right now.
Good job. Danica has had good work on pit lane this afternoon.
Everybody's in quick, and Elio Castroneves completes his pit stop first. By the line, but he took the inside line and he might have snookered Dario Franchitti. What do you think?
Yeah, wow. He did get by Franchitti.
That was some ducking and weaving there.
Yeah, no kidding.
But Briscoe was just hooking up enough to beat Franchitti to that line. Just as you're getting out of your box, he just had a little bit more forward bite with the rear tire spinning, and got him there. So I'm sure we'll hear from race control right now for these two guys to swap if what we just saw was correct on our board, and I think it was. Being those two guys right there, Franchitti to Briscoe.
Okay, look at the left of your screen. That's Danica behind Milka Duno. We're trying to maybe convince Milka to speed up just a little bit.
Yeah, but she didn't want to be on the inside of her there because Milka had a bail into her pit, so good heads up to get back to the fast lane.
Now watch this drag race here for Briscoe. He ducks to the inside and clearly gets him at the white line. That was awesome.
But guys, there may be a question mark as to whether it was entirely fair what Ryan Briscoe did. I'm here with Barry Wanzer, and Barry, you did have a chance to talk to the tech officials to get a ruling from upstairs. Have they given you an answer yet?
We haven't had an answer yet, but he's behind us on the track. We'll see how the restart plays out.
Here's what happened, fellas, and Ryan Briscoe actually said it on the radio. He was coming out. He had we've shown the steering wheel before, the pit limiter that limits the amount of speed. His thumb slipped off of it, and that was the rocket ship that I was referring to. So it'll be interesting to see where he restarts.
Does that mean he was speeding as he crossed the line?
But did he get caught speeding?
Exactly.
That's like, you can speed if you don't get caught, which is a great thing.
Honest officer, I was simply, my thumb fell off the button. That's why.
Well, the cleanup continues at the scene of the crash of Alex Lloyd, who has brought out yet another caution here at Twin Ring Motegi in the Indy Japan 300. We are in the home stretch of the 2010 Izod IndyCar season, and coming down the stretch, Will Power is at somewhat of a disadvantage because look at the number of oval wins that Will has in his resume. 0, while Dario Franchitti has 11. Now we are getting set for the restart here at Twin Ring Motegi. The order will remain the same. Castro Neves, Franchitti, Briscoe, Power, Patrick, and the green comes out, and here we go back to racing. We're on lap number 167.
And as we heard, Clive Howe said, now is the time to pounce, and he wants Briscoe to get up there and get on Franchitti for his guy, Will Power. Take those points.
Andretti and Graham Rahal battling for position for ninth. Graham running ninth. As we look back from Takuma Sato's car, there is Briscoe trying to get second from Dario.
He had a little bit of a look as he went down into three and said, no, I'm not there enough. Come on back, try it again.
And boy, Dario was committed. You could just see that momentum. That's like you let your foot in. Look at Will Power.
Yeah.
Yep.
Will's going to third.
Yeah, see, Briscoe won't fight him for that.
No, that was gracious.
Yep.
Absolutely.
That's not team orders, I doubt. That's just the fact that Will Power got a run, and there's no way Briscoe is going to hold him up.
Look at that pretty good gap, you know, kind of gapped in as they rolled into three there. But it's tough to stay right on the tail of the guy in front of you when you drive down into turn three, so you got to lay it back a little bit.
Danica Patrick having a great race. She's running in fifth. Has been in the top five just about all race long, trying to duplicate the feat that she pulled off here in 2008.
You heard her trying to squeeze back to Power. The sooner you can get back to full power, the best. But just have to do a little breathe back as you're coming off of four. Now you're just flat out, sixth gear. Should see the rev lights come up on her steering wheel. There they start to just kind of come up a little bit.
Danica's coming off a ninth place finish at Kentucky 2 weeks ago. Best finish of the year was a second at Texas.
Pretty good run off of four that time.
We see Marco Andretti battling with Dan Weldon, and that is for position. Move Marco up into 10th and Weldon down to 11th.
And Weldon, with all the laps that we saw him do in practice, he looked so consistent and confident just working traffic out there. I'm surprised. I would have thought he'd been more up in the top five, especially with the two top five finishes he's had prior to here, and he's coming back.
Yeah, he's going to get that position back.
You know, but that momentum he had as well, Weldon coming into here with the second and third, just gives you that extra little boost to run it in harder.
And that gives Takuma Sato, look at the run that he has now, closing right. That was actually not good timing. He closed at the wrong spot and had to bail out of it. Earlier, Jimmy Vassar was on the radio to Takuma, reminding him that he had more overtake assist than people around him, and asked him to use it at the appropriate times.
And when you're in the heat of the battle in the race car, sometimes that's a good reminder, because you get so caught up in what you're doing, you forget that you have that, and it's just a good friendly reminder.
Moto passes EJ Viso for 14th. Boy, you're off the throttle forever, aren't you?
And that's the big separator on this racetrack, and just what you heard there, Bob, is the guys that are off it for a lot longer, I mean, that's the difference of maybe 3 or 4 tenths around this racetrack, or setting yourself up to get a run to pass somebody getting off turn four.
And the reason you have to stay off the throttle is as soon as you pick up the throttle again, it won't turn, because that transfers weight to the back. So you need to have a car that's really stuck at the front if you're gonna pick up the throttle early.
One of the drivers having a great race is Graham Rahal, who's running in ninth position. There he is, just ahead of Dan Weldon. Graham is having a good race in the quick trim car for Newman Haas Racing. Graham Rahal running in ninth spot.
And as you said, Jan, he's disappointed because last year he had a great race car here and he said, I'm coming back here with my same engineer, Martin Paré, and you know, if we're not on the podium, I'm disappointed. But he had a moment in qualifying that says it was as big a moment as he's had in the car since he crashed in Homestead in 08.
And amazingly, he said it was two clicks on the weight jacker that he had pushed, and he clicked it twice, and the car got wicked loose.
Yeah.
That just shows how close these cars are to finding that just perfect edge.
To find that edge and be fast at this racetrack in that challenging 3 and 4, tough.
This will be our last commercial break before the checkered flag. We've 22 laps to go. Elio still leads at Motegi.
Elio Castroneves heading for his 23rd IRL championship winning race, and certainly hasn't put a foot wrong today, John.
It's absolutely a masterclass, to be honest with you. He's led, I think, every lap, hasn't he? And his car's looking fantastic when he's in no traffic. And to be honest, he's dealing with any traffic he comes across quite easily. And they're going quite slowly, some of the back markers as well, which is helping him. But he's looking very strong at the moment. I just can't see anyone being able to overtake him.
Interesting to see Ryan Briscoe quite so subservient, if I can use a word that might suit the situation well, to Will Power, as Will Power put him under a minor amount of pressure for the place.
Yes, I mean, we talked about that a little bit earlier on, and we mentioned that that might happen later in this race. As Will started to put Ryan under some pressure there, I think that he was maybe persuaded that leaving the door open at this stage in the championship when your teammate's fighting for it was possibly not a bad thing. So Will's now running in third place.
The power of contracts, eh, Johnny?
Well, I mean, there are rumours flying around that Ryan Briscoe might not be in the Penske next year, in the Penske fold-up. They're maybe bringing it down from three cars to two cars, so I suspect that he'll want to keep his nose clean and do a good job for the boss and hope that he remains in a drive next year.
And the main players are all in play. Franchitti in second place, Power in third place. This is going to go to the wire if it goes like this. Scott Dixon unable to join the fray. Would have been handy to have a Ganassi in there to help out.
And it's very surprising. Scott Dixon, especially with his record here, I mean, it's very surprising that he didn't. He was a bit perplexed after qualifying, which has actually been a feature recently in the last few races with him. And he's a very quick driver, and I'm surprised he's not up there with Dario being able to help him a bit more, but Dario seems to be able to do it pretty much on his own at the moment, so all looking good for him at the moment in terms of the championship, being not actually winning the race.
Dan Weldon as well, being just a little bit disappointing perhaps of the Brits at the moment, not getting to sorts with it as far as the race is concerned. Well, this is the Indy Japan 300 from Twin Ring Motegi. Out front is Elio Castroneves, but all eyes are on second and third places. Let's go back.
Bob Jenkins, Jan Bikas, Robbie Buell, and Jack Arup at Motegi, Twin Ring Motegi, first, second, and third as Elio continues to lead. There he is at the bottom of your screen, and here comes second and third, Dario and Ryan and Will Power, I should say. And the point spread right now is 12. Power's lead over Dario Franchitti. Castroneves 86 behind in the point standings. Elio has pretty much dominated this race as we continue to look at second and third. The last time he got the two bonus points for leading the most laps was at Chicago in 2008. That's kind of hard to believe, isn't it?
Well, nobody has to be in Will Power's ear right now telling him where Franchitti is, because he's right there in front of him.
Yep.
I'm sure Clive Hall is in his ear telling him something, but it's not where Franchitti is on the racetrack.
Yeah. Laps are clicking down. 14 laps to go as Elio crossed the line that time. His lead, 3.2 seconds.
And he's closing in. He's got to think a lot about how aggressive does he want to be. Points-wise, you'd love to have that position, but you don't want to get it wrong.
But he wants to get as close as he can to Franchitti just to let him know he's there.
Oh, yeah.
And say, hey, my car's faster than you, and I'm going to make a move. Or at least let Dario think that.
Yeah. I think Dario has it in hand, but it's so interesting that he said, we don't care what Power does, and we don't pay attention to him. But right now, you look in the mirror and say, you pay attention to Will Power. Yeah.
you know, very, very similar, potentially, leaving here. When we go to that final race at Homestead, it's just flat out. Who wins down there, you know, potentially is our champion. I mean, you know, almost takes us back to, you know, a starting position after 17 races. He's closer.
Guys, you were wondering what Clive Howell may be saying to Will Power. How about nothing? They've gone radio silent for the last five laps.
Thank you, Jack.
Yeah, well, that's an indicator of, remember, because it was earlier where Clive was calling him and saying, hey, remember who we're racing, remember who we're racing, and he got that rather colorful exchange back from Will Power. I know what I am doing. So he's letting him do what he knows what he's doing right now.
Sometimes when you get in that cockpit, you can get pretty animated. You know, it's a little different person sometimes with that helmet on in that cockpit versus the guy standing on the wall talking to his crew guys about the car. You transform a little bit.
Saw the graphic there. Elio is still turning laps at 197 miles an hour, and Dario also.
It's been Elio's day, that's for sure.
Yep.
He had that one wiggle that put him back. Thankfully, he caught it, and other than that, he has been dominant.
And it started with what he did in qualifying. You know, and the confidence that he has in that race car. And the guys putting the setup on the car saying, I know it can do this, and I'm going to run flat out around this racetrack. I don't care. I believe in myself, in this race car, in this team.
And he believed in himself last year, right? Up until he hit the wall.
But I think that just says so much about his willingness to be the best and to be the fastest.
Yeah.
Because like you said, Cole, you got to be committed to run flat out into turn three, and you better hope it works. And last year,
it did.
Another indication of how strong Elio's car has been. He has 8 overtakes remaining. The most of anyone still on track. Dario has 2 remaining and Will Power 4. And then Briscoe has 7 and Danica Patrick has 4, Jack.
Maybe the best compliment that you can give to a driver comes from one that we all respect, named Rick Mears. Rick has worked with Will Power, and I had breakfast with Rick this morning. And I asked him what he thought of this driver from down under, and he said, Jack, he is exactly like I was. All he wants to do is race, and he breaks each race down into not individual laps, but individual turns. He said, when I work with Will Power, I see myself in the mirror. That's a pretty strong endorsement, guys.
Yeah, it sure is. And Will continues to eat into the advantage that Dario has over him as they come up on a slower car. That would be Milka Duno. Ooh.
There, he's got a little bit of a run.
Oh, he tries to go inside. Not close enough. 4 laps to go for Elio Castroneves. We continue to watch the championship contenders running 2nd and 3rd.
And those are the opportunities that we just saw that Will Power has to be looking for, is a car that these guys will be coming up on and to set that up. But not to get so, excited, here's my opportunity, that you would challenge that corner just like, you know, there he was maybe going to do something with Dario. No, he wasn't. That was way too high risk and percentage-wise.
Apparently, we're going to tie the record for fewest number of leaders and for the fewest lead changes. So far, we have had 3 of both of them, and with a little more than 2 laps to go, we would think that that is going to be the situation. It's just amazing how every year the battle for the championship goes to the final race. I mean, other series manufacture a championship at the end, but not the Izod IndyCar series.
It's been incredible. Yep. Absolutely.
Here is Elio. White flag, one more lap to go. Here comes second and third. Dario is 4.7 seconds behind. And Willpower has Dario where he wants him.
So Charles Burns could be looking for a big hug from Elio again.
That's right. Well, fuel strategy helped him win in Kentucky. Today it was sheer speed and skill as Elio Castroneves wins the Indy Japan 300 at Twin Ring Motegi. Power third, Briscoe fourth, Danica Patrick comes home in fifth position. Here come the remainder of the top 10. Ray Hall moved up a position near the end of the race and went to eighth. Alex Tagliani gets a good finish in 13th. And Justin Wilson finishes in 16th position. And those were the cars that were on the lead lap at the finish. Elio's third win of 2010. He also won at Barber last or 2 weekends ago at Kentucky and here at Motegi. And it's also his second win at this racetrack. He also won here in 2006. And it's his 25th career open wheel win, tying him with Gordon Johncock for 14th on the all-time win list.
Elio Castroneves, winner. And his face will go on the trophy. And he just gets told by his team. Getting the congratulations.
You are the man! You are the man, man! Good job, well done.
Ah, well done! Nice drive,
this is baby. Please don't clean it, don't clean it.
Don't clean it, he says. Hey, you told the crew, they did what they had to do, you did what you had to do.
That's what I was all about. Team Penske, it's about execution. They gave me a fantastic car. And man, it was awesome. It was like 2006, the car was on rails. And every time I wanted to go for it, the car was responding. So great job for the guys in the shop. They did a hell of a job to put a great package like this, and they paid off. So thank you, Team Penske over there in Charlotte. Well done, and man, I'm as happy as can be, Jack, my man.
He's happy, but I wonder how much happier he would have been if it hadn't been for Edmonton, of course. Stop giggling.
Oh, boy.
He's an emotional man, Pippa, isn't he? I mean, he's enjoying his day, but he'll probably start to think about Edmonton. If I hadn't had that blocking situation, I'd be in with a chance of this championship.
Yes, that probably will start to play on his mind, especially if he has a great result in Homestead. The difficulty is that in Helio's mind, he still won the race in Edmonton. So although they took the win away from him and took the points away from him, and the way the rules are written, there's nothing else they could have done in that situation. In his mind, he still should have won the race. So maybe they'll reword the rules next year and Helio will come away happier.
Indeed, but Dario's going to be fairly happy here, isn't he? At the end of the day, he's managed to pick off that second place. He's held Will Power at bay, and it goes to the wire.
Fantastic race for Dario. I mean, just set it up for Miami, really, and Dario's always really strong at Miami. Hopefully Scott Dixon can get up there and help. I think it might actually revolve a little bit around how the teammates of the various of Will Power and Dario respectively can actually get out there and actually run together with their teammates and help them win the championship. And obviously Will Power's got the advantage, as we saw earlier, he's got two quick guys out there helping him.
While Dario was under that pressure from Will Power, you didn't get the impression that he was going to give the place up readily, but Will Power seemed to spend a long time back in sixth place in amongst the draft of other cars and the like. Do you think it might have been that once he got in cleaner air, he had a better car under him?
That may well have been the case, and it often is the case with a faster car that sometimes the more dirty air you're in, the more difficult it becomes to drive. Also, don't forget, this is Will's first time to this track in Japan. He's never been there before, so maybe he was just being cautious for the first pass of the race. And in America, when it gets down to the last 50 laps on an oval, it's go time. So maybe he got the message that it was time to start moving forwards, and that's when he really started to go after Dario.
Well, Will Power minimised the damage, I suppose, as far as the points were concerned. But Alex Lloyd was a man that found himself in all sorts of trouble. Had a problem out on the track at one point, and then this. Johnny, no, I think we can say that was fairly hard in there.
That's a big hit. That's a really big hit, and I'm just glad that he seemed to get out and everything's fine. But as ever, we always say in the studio, when you see crashes like that, they always look on television quite innocuous, but when you're sat in a car and it hits a barrier, even a safety barrier like that at 200 plus miles an hour, it's always going to knock the breath out of you.
Pippa, it looked like something broke on that car.
It did look like something broke. From the way it took off the track and just stopped turning, it really looked like something broke. And to go back to Johnny's point, They're called the safer barrier. It's called the soft barrier. I've hit them at 200 miles an hour. They're not that soft. It really hurts. And Alex went in really hard, so it was great to see him get out and walk away.
They're either that not that soft or you're a lot harder than you look.
One or the other,
I
guess.
One or the other. Now then, down on pit road, of course, we had quite a lot of shenanigans throughout the day. Briscoe and Franchitti, I wanted to take a look at this if we can as well. Johnny, talk us through this. This was the point where I think he gave up the place, Briscoe. He looked like he gained the place on Dario.
Well, he gained it, but apparently he said he took his... He also, as Pippa pointed out earlier on, actually went into the final bit box as well. So, but I think that was probably more to do, he wouldn't have known that too much, he would have been looking at Dario on his right. I think it was more to do with the fact that he felt maybe he'd speeded, and if he'd actually end up catching and putting in front of Dario, they might have looked a little bit more closely at that. So perhaps he was thinking very quickly and his instinct was to let Dario have the spot back.
A lot of pressure on him, pit road, isn't there, for the team to get it right?
There's a huge amount of pressure. There's pressure on the drivers, there's pressure on the teams, and when you pull out of those pit boxes, it gets so tight and narrow and close down there. And at this track, it's not a traditional oval. It's actually a little bit more difficult to pass on than some of the traditional ovals. So if you can gain a place on pit road, you really, really want that place.
Especially when it's as tight as it is right now at the top of the tree. Just 12 points now separated. It was 59 three races ago, down to 17 last time out. And now Will Power only has a 12-point lead over Dario and Franchitti with one race left to go. Elio Castroneves out of it now, of course, even with 53 points, which is the maximum you can get. Elio Castroneves is out of it. So it's a two-horse race. Scott Dixon is on 90. Of course, it could bring Ganassi up in front of the Elio if he can for third place. Ryan Briscoe, Ryan Hunter-Reay, Tony Kanaan. Dan Weldon is eighth now, but a long way off, equal on 221 points with Marco Andretti. And Justin Wilson there in 10th place for Dreyer and Reinbold. Miami next. Johnny, one to look forward to.
Yes, I think it's going to be a great race. I mean, the championship organisers will be very, very pleased that it's gone into the final race with a real championship battle on their hands, and obviously two dominating drivers. So to be honest, one of Will Power or Dario deserved to win it, and it'll be interesting to see who does. I'm putting my money and my heart on Dario. Obviously he's a good friend of mine, so I'm hoping that his experience will pay off and Will might blink first.
Your first trip to Sky Sports Studio, that's the tough question that comes to you as well. Who's going to do it when we get to Homestead?
Well, my heart and my money is on Will. If I had to go with my head, unfortunately, I'd probably agree with Johnny, but I know Will. I train with him at PitFit. He's a great guy. He's had such an amazing comeback this year. He's got so much better at the oval thing this year, and it would just really finish off his comeback story if he could win the title. So I'm with Will.
Power, though, has never beaten Dario Franchitti on an oval yet.
No, he hasn't, but interestingly, with the points the way they are in this series, the gap from first to second is 10 points. So if Dario wins and gets pole, that's 11 points. As long as he doesn't lead the most laps, Will can still come second and just win the championship by 1 point. If Dario leads the most laps, wins and gets pole, second's not enough.
It's going to be a close
one. Wrong mindset, though. Wrong mindset. You can't go in there thinking like that or he will lose it. Definitely. So I think Dario's got less pressure because obviously he's catching up as well. So he's the guy catching up behind. He doesn't need to look in his mirrors.
I would agree with that. Sorry. Dario's definitely the guy with less pressure and Will probably feels it all on his shoulders at the moment.
It's going to be red hot in Florida, so just the one race to go and we're heading for a title deciding showdown in Miami between Will Power and Dario Franchitti.
Get ready for the showdown. Get ready for the showdown. Yo, it's about to go down.
He has dominated the road and street courses in the Izod IndyCar Series this year.
Dario Franchitti will win, trailed by Will Power.
It's going down, it's going down, It's going down, it's going down, It's coming, yeah, it's coming, yeah,
We the showstoppers, show rockers, show y'all how we rock shit, gotcha.
Join us in 2 weeks' time for the spectacular season finale from Homestead, Miami. We're on Sky Sports 4 from 11:30 p.m. on Saturday, October 2nd. But for now, that's all from us. My thanks to Pippa Mann and Johnny Molan for their company today. And after 16 races, it all comes down to the final one to decide the title. Will Power and Dario Franchitti go head-to-head at Homestead. See you then.
We're on the road.
Come on, catch
More sport, news, views and video on Sky Player, Sky Mobile TV and at skysports.com.